morning, everybody.
I'm Richard Griffiths. I'm the president of the board of directors for the Georgia First Amendment Foundation, and we're just delighted to have you all here at this year's legislative breakfast. Thanks to the team that put that together, Kathy Brister closing the doors back there, and there are many other great folks who to thank for this. I'm sure this is going to be a very lively discussion of open government and free speech issues that are emerging from the current General Assembly session. Let me offer a word of thanks to the Georgia State University Law School Chapter of the National Lawyers Guild for providing the space and organizing logistics. And thanks especially to law school students and guild members Jobina Hill and Megan Harrison. Where are you? Yay, thank you so much. I'm going to leave it to Peter Canfield, today's moderator, a First Amendment lawyer and a founding Georgia First Amendment Foundation board member, to lead our esteemed panel. Peter, thank you.
Thank you, Richard, and thanks everyone for being here. We have a lot we can discuss today, and we are very open to any issues that you want to raise with any of the panelists. So we want to make this as interactive as possible. You should have before you a program that has the full bios of our panelists. I'm going to briefly introduce them before we get started. To my right is State Representative Wendell Willard, who is chairman of the House Judiciary Committee and has been deeply involved in open government issues during his legislative career. And this is his last session in the legislature. So we're very
applause, everybody.
And to his right is Lisa Cupid, who is a Cobb County Commissioner who deals with government transparency issues, the front line every day on the government side as she represents her district, and she's also a member of the board of the Georgia First Amendment Foundation. And to her right is Tom Clyde, who's a First Amendment attorney with Kilpatrick Townsend, and also co-chair of the Georgia First Amendment Foundation Legal Committee. He follows open government legislation through the General Assembly each year, prepares the Foundation's legislative watch, which is posted on the Foundation website, which analyzes where legislation is, what the Foundation's view of it is, and we'd encourage you to look at that. And finally, to his right is Samira Jafari, who's an executive editor at CNN, where she's the manager of The Row. Richard is an emeritus manager of The Row. So we're very glad to have Samira here. She's responsible for ensuring that the network's stories meet the high standards of storytelling, accuracy, and fairness, and she is also on the board of the Georgia First Amendment Foundation. I am going to kick off the discussion by inviting each panelist to share with us for a few minutes or so what's top of their mind in terms of how they believe that, you know, better government transparency can best be fostered and free speech protections can be advanced in Georgia. So Lisa, we'd like to start with you, if you would.
Thank you, Peter. Good morning, everyone. From serving on the Board of Commissioners for the past 5 years, sometimes it's hard to believe that I'm on the other side of things. And it's unfortunate, but reality is that when you do become an elected official, you do seem to be on another side, and that there are two sides of the matter, the public and those who are in elected office. And when matters come up where the two don't necessarily come together well, or there's points at issue, I think it's very easy for us to have an adversarial relationship. But sometimes it's just the different roles that we may play in the public realm that makes this relationship more adversarial than it ought to be. And one area where I see that being played out in is in the matter of open records. And I really sought the opportunity to address this morning because I just wanted to share that it doesn't necessarily have to be an adversarial process. And in fact, if you're leaning on that one tool to get information in an adversarial manner, you might not get that information in a way that's helpful to you or your organization. Because sometimes openness is as helpful as it is relevant to you. So if someone's being open and they open the floodgates where, for instance, not to put anyone out there, but when a certain elected official was asked to produce certain documents and they produced thousands of pages of a document and said, okay, you find what you need in there, that's not really helpful to you, even though that's being open. And a way to fine tune the information that you're trying to gather, I think, can hinge off of something that we all know is very important in the work that we do, and that's just relationships. And if you don't have the relationship that you desire with that elected official, just general communication. And it doesn't necessarily have to be adversarial communication. So what can be seen as adversarial communication? There's a gentleman in our community in Cobb who likes to say, well, I demand that you send us this document because we know that you have not been open or you have not been forthright with us about it, versus someone else who could come to us and say, look, I'm interested in knowing about X. Can you please send us a documentation with respect to it? Without even going through open records requests, an elected official might be more inclined to give that second person that information just because that elected official may have had no reason to withhold it in the first place. But if you're coming to them in an adversarial manner, then they might make you go through each of the hoops, try to get information and produce more than what you thought you would get. And that has real implications today because when you are getting documents through open records, those come at a cost, right? A cost per page, a cost the person's time that they're spending on getting those open records. So if I can stress anything, it's just don't necessarily presume that the person who is the elected official in that manner, it necessarily is purposefully or adversarially withholding information from you. They may actually want you to get information because they may see that you can shine a light on a matter more than they can by bringing it out in the open. And relationships go a long way. If you know somebody who serves on a board, if you know that elected official, just talking to them again beyond the communication, that can help in the process of getting the documentation that you need. And I'm not saying, please don't say Commissioner Cupid said, don't use open records requests in a formal manner to get what you need. But I'm just saying it may not necessarily need to be done in an adversarial manner or sometimes even the most formal manner. You might get what you want, exactly what you want sooner.
Lisa, just one follow-up on that. I know so often the issue is that the citizen or the journalist who wants information doesn't really understand what records the county has or how they're maintained or who to ask for them. And a lot of times the default is just make a very broad request and see what the response is. Is there a better way to do that?
I mean, there are various ways, but at least for Cobb County, the steward of our documentation is going to be the county clerk. And they really don't have a dog in the fight and can be very helpful in directing you to the resources that you need. Sometimes it's presumed when we get demands that we know where documents are, but we're the decision makers. Somebody else is actually documenting the decisions that we make. So we have a lot of reliance on the clerk's office to hold information. And a lot of times they may be able to get it to the right person who needs that information. Beyond that, a good resource to go to is the county attorney's office. But just know, once you step into that legal realm, they're going to probably ask you to follow a more formal process, which could delay things, but it just depends on how quick you need information. So they will reach out to elected officials. They'll let us know we have X amount of time to produce X amount of documents. And so depending on how quickly you want something that might not be the best choice, but that's also an avenue someone could take.
Before we get off that topic, Chairman Willard, you're both a legislator and an attorney.
Yep. And I've been a city attorney and a county attorney. And follow up what Lisa says. The request would come in, Peter, and it may not be phrased well enough to understand exactly what the person's asked for. And either department personnel come to me or the clerk, city clerk who does it, as you say in our case, the city clerk is the clearing office for it. And I say, call them up. Get an email to them. Find out exactly clarification what they're asking for, rather than saying, your request is rejected because we don't understand it. Mm-hmm. These are people who are citizens and have certainly a right to full access to any record maintained by the government, unless there's some calls, for instance, the social security numbers and things of that nature, home addresses of people. But the thing I find about open records is there's always a feeling of an attitude of being negative about something if you hold back or refuse to give something. If you don't have the information, the inclination is to be negative about it. And the more you have the opportunity to receive that information, the more you understand and get clarification on what that issue is. So I've always been a strong advocate of open records with legislation as well as my work as an attorney.
Good. Samira, what is on your mind these days in terms of access issues?
Well, I'll kind of speak on a larger, you know, national scope, and then kind of, you know, bring it a little bit more specific to Georgia, because I think right now what we're facing is this general almost daily attack on the media from the top down, and I think what that can do is kind of create this this long game of this, you know, kind of normalization of resisting media requests. And I think that's generally concerning for every journalist out there if you have an administration who consistently undermines the free press, then what, and that starts trickling from the top down, depending on the community, depending on the department, you know, the agency you're trying to seek records from, there can establish a culture of resistance. I think for us, what often happens is, and I completely agree with Lisa, because, you know, when I was a beat reporter, a crime reporter, a state house reporter, relationships benefited those reporters so much because, you know, you gain this trust and respect with the people, the very people you're trying to access records from, and they know you're a reliable journalist, they know you're trying to get the facts, you're serving your community. I think what often happens with the larger news organizations like us that have so much reach is two things. One, the reporters themselves are pivoting from one story to another story to another story and filing all kinds of requests for hundreds of different stories. It might be, you know, fighting the Kendrick Johnson, you know, type battle in Georgia where the case was closed and we had to litigate to get those records. And it might be, you know, filing records for what's going on with the Las Vegas shooting. And it might, and you're constantly pivoting. And I think the secondary thing to that is we're CNN, or our reach is huge. And I think there's a general, sometimes local fear of like, oh gosh, if I do something, are they making me, you know, sound a certain way, or they don't, you know, it's not just in your community or in your town, it's all the way to Mumbai. So I think that kind of is a tough act for us to balance on our end. But, you know, we've had some really great wins, and we've sometimes not. And I think in talking to the journalists that I deal with in terms of vetting their pieces, a lot of times the frustration is that we don't have a lot of recourse. I mean, they can just say no, and then we're forced to litigate, which is not ideal. And that can drag out the story for months and years and, you know, what have you. I think the other thing, too, is for us, you know, especially when you take something relatively new, like the wave of all these police departments kind of either jumping on board or not with, you know, body cam videos, for example, right? That's relatively new, and you have this wave of these departments doing it, whether it be in Georgia or not. But there isn't really, it's kind of like the wild, wild west, if you will. Like, we don't know what's going on here. I mean, some people, one, they don't have it, or they have it, but their policy of releasing it is different, putting it to the law differently. It's almost like we haven't kept up with that development. And so for us, it's video is everything to a network like us. Video means facts, right? And that's, and to try to navigate those choppy waters right now is just, it's just tricky. Wherever you land on it, it's just difficult, and we're always trying to seek some clarity on that. And generally, my thing as a reporter and a manager has kind of always been a concern about privatization. To me personally, it's you know, just especially when you cover the criminal justice system, but also other entities. The more they take this cost-cutting approach to bringing private leadership or ownership of certain entities like prisons or even parking tickets or virtually anything to streamline costs, that poses a challenge to open records, right? And so that's always a general concern. So, but for us, we'll always advocate anything that has leadership leaning toward openness and making that the rule, with some exceptions about privacy and protecting minors or protecting victims, versus, you know, the general rule of resistance and us finding exceptions where we can get the documentation. So it's generally where we stand on this.
Thank you. Tom, talking about things like body cam video and other new issues, where does that issue, for example, stand now in Georgia? And what other issues are you looking at in terms of unclear legal questions or bills before the legislature?
Sure. So I think there's really four areas right now where I feel like over the last few years we've lost some ground in terms of access to records or access to information. Certainly one of them is police body camera video. Over the last few sessions, stretching back to the 2015 session, there's been two bills that have passed in an effort to clarify the public's right of access to police body cam video. Unfortunately, neither of those has succeeded in making the issue clear to law enforcement agencies. Even Georgia law enforcement agencies have an enormous level of variation on how they handle police body camera video, from simply essentially refusing to provide it to the public, to some police agencies trying to be more affirmative in giving public access to it. But legislation passed in 2002, different bills in the 2015 and 2016 sessions. The general tenor of those bills was that when police are in a private environment, when their police body camera is operating inside a home or in other private environment, there will be limitations on access to that video. But when they're in a public setting, that should be available to the public. Unfortunately, as a practical matter, that has not clarified issues. There remains a great deal of confusion over how the investigative exception in the Open Records Act applies to body camera video. And so, as a practical matter, the public access in Georgia is very uneven. Other areas where there's big issues at the moment. A huge one is simply the investigative records exception. When the Open Records Act got rewritten under Attorney General Olin's, included language that very forcefully said an agency that is under investigation for wrongdoing cannot invoke the investigative exception itself to conceal records. That investigative exception is supposed to be there for law enforcement, to allow law enforcement to protect their records. That clarification was needed because City of Atlanta Public Schools have themselves resisted providing records about the grading scandal that had taken place inside that school system. by trying to invoke that as exception. And so that had been very clear in the law. Unfortunately, in a decision from the Georgia Court of Appeals in the last couple of years, the Court of Appeals essentially interpreted that to mean that clarification only applies when the agency is under investigation, if an individual within the agency is under investigation. A agency can still invoke the investigative exception. Let me explain what that means as a practical matter. Chatham County Sheriff's Office, Sheriff's Department, had an individual who was badly beaten inside the Chatham County Detention Center. A television station from Media General at the time asked for access to the video of that that demonstrated the individual had been beaten. The Chatham County Sheriff's Department said, no, we're not going to give you that. It's under investigation. And so essentially the fact that somebody had been beaten inside the detention center remained outside the reach of the media. And the media understandably said, look, you're the agency under investigation. You can't invoke that exception. If GBI invokes it, that might be something different. But you're the agency under investigation. The Court of Appeals, unfortunately, backed up the Chatham County Sheriff's Department and said they can invoke that exception because it's not the agency that's under investigation. It's an individual Sheriff's Department employees who's under investigation. That, it's always individuals that are under investigation. Individuals are the people who face the consequences. And so it essentially eviscerated the language that said that Attorney General Owens had inserted. So hopefully in a future year that will get corrected. I'm going to briefly touch on two other issues that remain a big problem. Just very recently, the Georgia Supreme Court concluded that court reporter recordings of the courtroom proceedings are not subject to the open, not subject to government the access to court records because they don't actually get filed in the court file with the case. That's very unfortunate, particularly unfortunate to the emerging media of podcasts, which is frequently needs access to that audio in order to make effective podcasts about past court proceedings. Another issue that's been unfortunate is in a recent Court of Appeals case, there was an interpretation again of the Open Records Act that said the fines that the new Open Records Act applies if people do not comply with the Open Records Act will not apply to agencies. They will only apply to individual persons. I do not think that was ever the intent of the way it was written. The fines are intended to apply to the agency. What if it's really going to be imposed on individual persons, they're going to be used much less frequently. And so there's issues that over the last few years have created holes in what we thought was the tapestry that protects access to government records. And so my hope is that over the next few years in the Georgia General Assembly, we can tackle some of those and correct them and make these records accessible to the public again.
Thank you, Tom. Chairman Willard, let me ask you what's on your mind and also if you've thought about or have any thoughts on what the issues Tom has mentioned.
Thank you, Peter. I do have thoughts, and as you suggested, Tom, maybe need to come back and visit the General Assembly again to clarify that if that's been so interpreted. The intent was, of course, again to improve the access of records, public records, through the rewriting of that law, and also to do some clarification which was needed, I think, in means of how you get access and standards of how you do it. So, but That was not what we expected, put it that way. I think the people of the General Assembly as a whole are very supportive of having access to records by the public. We'll have debates about it, but at least I'll speak on my committee. When we have bills coming through dealing with that, we're generally very open to try and have proper laws put in place to ensure the public is getting access. The body camera helped craft that language with the intent that there would be ability to get access to it and how long the agencies had to hold on to the records. We do recognize there is a quote, the also constitutional right of privacy that enters into play when you say you're inside someone's home. You've got to announce the fact that you have a body camera on this money. And otherwise, you're out in the public, you're in a public place, there's no need to, because all that is available, as we know through many years of decisions on that point. The idea is a good thing, because we try to also clarify what do you have to retain in these body camera records. And we hopefully make sure that anything that involves an incident where there is a need for the police to respond to potential criminal conduct, traffic accidents, etc., they will have to retain those type records. If they come on someone who's having a flat tire to help them call a record or something, that's not something normally kept as a record. And the reason it became an issue is how much can you hold on the hardware? Because you got, say, in a city of Sandy Springs, you got 120 policemen out with body cameras from time to time. The capacity of what we have is limited, even with the cost to try to expand it, to maintain for a period of over 2 years. We required it for 30 months. And the reason we looked at 30 months is the fact that most actions, as far as civil actions, are going to be brought if there's an injury involved within the 2 year statute of limitations, plus a period of time for discovery by the party. So we made it mandated they have to keep at least 30 months. And we also gave what we feel is good standards of what is recognized to be when that record has to be retained. So there is a desire, I say in the General Assembly, to be sure that we do have good open records in the state. The bill you talk about that Sam Owens had came through our committee, Jay Powell and I worked on it quite a bit, and we thought we were getting some leeway with improvements on that. So what you're saying is something we need to come back and probably revisit and clarify.
Chairman Willard, are there any bills that affect these issues that you think are likely to move through the General Assembly this year and get some attention?
Not in general as far as open records, but if somebody touches on open records, that's the bill that we have coming from the Senate, and I have not read the bill, but it deals with the lotteries and the payout of awards for lotteries. And there's a question about keeping confidential the names of the parties who win lotteries. I have a concern about that because, if you remember in the press, I think the last 60 days, we had articles about there are apparently people who learn how to game the game, meaning that they are getting several awards over a period of time, and the lottery has picked that up and has challenged some of these awards, saying, you know, somehow this person's got information. I mean, the odds are impossible for a person, same person, to win four or five or six times, or for a place to have the awards coming out of there four or five or six times. Just use that as a general example. And I think that's something that the public and the press needs to have knowledge of and be able to look into it also. So I have concerns, how far do we go in making a limitation on those type of records? Carol mentioned something which they looked at talking to her earlier. Kennesaw, they had a discussion about this, and the point was maybe just delay the time to let a person who got a substantial award to prepare themselves before the name became public. but it still should be public information. You're getting funds paid out to you by a governmental body.
Tom, any bills that you're watching?
Certainly, the one that Representative Willard mentioned is one that we're watching and hope does not proceed for exactly the reasons that he mentioned. We also have Senator McCoon here today, and welcome him. But he has proposed a bill that would correct the problem that was created by the undisclosed case. That's the case where the Georgia Supreme Court held that court reporter's recording of a courtroom is not presumptively a court record that is available to the public. A court can choose to make it available to the public, but it's under no requirement to make it available to the public. And Senator McCoon has proposed a bill that will correct that, which the sentiment to correct that is terrific, and we appreciate that. We are concerned that that bill reaches so far it would move the issue of access to court records out of the way the current system is you get access to court records under basic sort of First Amendment principles that have been established by the court system. You get access to the agencies of the executive branch through the Open Records Act. We are concerned that this bill would actually move your right of access to court records out of the First Amendment context and into the Open Records Act context. The problem with that is the Open Records Act, as I think most of this audience is familiar with, can be a very bulky mechanism to try and obtain records. There's a lot of exceptions to the Open Records Act. There's fees that are connected with it, and there's time delays that are sometimes connected with it. And so our hope would be that actually we could try and move to a place where court reporter recordings are included in the court file so that they are accessible to the public. But remain accessible under traditional First Amendment principles, not under the Open Records Act principles.
Any other bills that are?
At this point, I would say there are not other bills that are a huge concern. What I would say is we are at the pivot point for the General Assembly. In other words, bills can still land at this point that can move through the General Assembly, and frequently records issues are handled very late in the session. And Chairman Willard can certainly speak to that. Things can be added to bills at the end of the session that can have grave consequences. I'll give you an example of that. Several years ago, in the very end of the session, a bill was adjusted so that when requests are made to the athletic departments of the university systems of Georgia, the response date is delayed by 90 days. That was legislation we never had a chance to really see coming. It was added at the very end of a session to a pre-existing bill, and has caused, frankly, the public's access to athletic department issues to diminish considerably. You're basically obtaining records. If you obtain them at all, you are obtaining them so much after the issues involved that the ability of the public to have a voice in those issues is kind of lost.
Before I open it up for questions, which I hope there are some, one issue that I'd like to give everybody on the panel a chance to comment on is one that certainly may be coming up in Georgia as well as elsewhere in the country. Atlanta is on the Amazon headquarters list, huge economic development opportunity. Apparently, part of that will be the offering of incentives. question about whether those, what sort of public window there will be into that process. I'm going to ask Lisa, maybe you to touch on this first, since you went through a similar situation locally in Cobb County with the Brave City.
Sure. The elements of the deal are one thing, but the manner of incentives is another. Typically, those are out in the open of what those incentives would be, at least for Cobb County. We'd like to think Cobb County's in the running, even though we're not considered Atlanta. But we publish all of our incentives on our website, so it should be made available. Now, the structure of the deal, that is something that may not necessarily be made open, and sometimes can provide a greater benefit to the organization, in this case Amazon, than the incentives themselves. And that is probably where there may be a greater concern about transparency. And it's something that, you know, arguably we did not do well in Cobb. And I don't know if we have enough mechanisms in place to overcome that, because there is always that challenge that if things become too out in the open, you might lose the benefactor of the deal. So it's difficult to say how incentives would have an impact.
Samira, let me ask you on this issue. Since it is a national story in a way, is it one that, and I know there's always the argument, when this issue comes up in Georgia, that, well, Georgia shouldn't be more open, because if it's more open, it will let competitors for that project gain access to what Georgia's doing, and that'll give them an unfair advantage. I don't know if this is an issue you're dealing with or seeing at CNN.
Not necessarily directly, but to me, if there's a anytime one of these, you know, big corporations wants to settle anywhere, inevitably we're going to talk about whether or not it's going to truly improve employment. We're going to think about what the tax breaks are going to be. We're going to think about whether the wages are going to be fair. And this is these are details, the structure of the plan, where taxpayer dollars are going. I'm not in the business of trying to necessarily make, you know, one community more competitive than another community. I want to know what kind of impact that development is going to have on the community, and the community deserves to know. And so if there, oh, I've never been accused of being too quiet. Thank you. But to me, it's like, that's all part of the story. I don't think we can immerse ourselves in thinking like, oh, because we're in Atlanta, that we have to be somehow sensitive to protecting a deal or what have you, so Atlanta gets it. For us, it's about cutting through. You know, one of my favorite professors passed away this week at University of Georgia. His name was Barry Hollander, and some of you might know him. And his whole philosophy was cut through the BS and get the facts. I mean, we're not here to join the story or be a part of the story. We're trying to tell the public what's going to happen if Amazon comes, and it might look like it might be a great thing if we get it. It might not be a great thing, but you deserve to know the facts of every level of that process. And what you don't want is have something that was quietly brought in as a very positive thing, and then once it's too late, you find out that it's not all you hope for. And we've seen this happen a million times. Our role is to bring up as many facts as possible and to dig on this, whether it be us or the AJC or whoever. But in terms of whether or not revealing too much might make it less competitive or not, I mean, that I don't feel comfortable making us a part of that, you know, position.
Tom, can you give us a sense of what the law is in Georgia? What rights do we have to see what's going on in this process as it happens?
Sure. Unfortunately, it's a difficult situation. In the rewrite of the Open Records Act that we were talking about before, one of the adjustments that got made in the Open Records Act was that there would be an exception for the Georgia Department of Economic Development when it is pursuing large deals for the state of Georgia And so if it involves more than $25 million, and that's certainly the case in Amazon, the Department of Economic Development is allowed to negotiate in secret, keep its records secret, and what is obligated to do is once a deal is reached to have a full disclosure, a complete disclosure of all of the terms of that, and allow the public to see essentially what the terms are before the government agencies involved actually vote and approve the deal. That was expanded over the last couple of years to include other state-level agencies. So it's not just the Georgia Department of Economic Development, but other state-level agencies can also invoke that secrecy. The current environment is unusual because the proposals that are being made to Amazon are so large, they involve all levels of government and land in a variety of different government agencies. And so theoretically, some of those local agencies may be obligated to disclose records. I don't think that's occurring. I don't know that it will occur. I'm disappointed in Amazon because Amazon is actually pushing, their agenda is to keep this secret. They are not asking for the local state-level agencies to be disclosing information. They are instead asking everybody to sign non-disclosure agreements. So it is very much a traditional environment where they're playing one state off against the others to try and get as much money as they can. And let me just give you a perspective about why I think that's terrible. And I have absolutely no connections whatsoever to Home Depot other than being an observer that have watched it succeed and grow in this state. Home Depot has been just an enormously successful company in this state. It competes against Amazon on a daily basis. It has grown here. It has brought hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of well-paid executives. It has created a huge tax base. It is really a Georgia success story. And it didn't get any perks for doing that. It did it organically. And then another Amazon can simply sweep in from another coast and demand $50 billion in basically payments from the state. If I'm Home Depot, that doesn't seem right.
Lisa, you had a thought before we turned to Chairman Willard.
Oh yeah, just a caveat. You know, you mentioned that there may be different layers of government involved. At the local level, if anything involves real estate, we have the ability to discuss those things in executive session. So there may not be an airing of detail publicly during those sessions that one might think they could have access to.
Chairman Willard, any thoughts?
Well, don't stone me. I do see the purpose and need, I guess, from my seat as a member of the General Assembly in having these this ongoing negotiation be retained as confidential because you are competing against other locations. And also, as you say, this major potential employer looking at your state and locations is expecting it to be maintained confidential. But if we didn't have the confidentiality part of it during these negotiation stages, you'd have one state location being able to overcome, bid against what they know is coming out of Georgia. We're told that if there is, in fact, a sincere opportunity for us to be a major player on that point, we'll probably have a special session to deal with these benefits. Of course, when we have a session, there's going to then be a full disclosure of whatever we're talking about as far as those various, we call it, not benefits, but so thirdly, what we're going to provide to them, whether it's infrastructure, land, etc. It plays on the basis of having 20,000 jobs plus, I think, they estimate salaries of over $800,000 each one of those people. States drool over that. That is a major economic impact to anybody who obtains that. And I agree, Home Depot, of course, is a major player, but they grew one store at a time, as opposed to saying, we're ready to move our headquarters with our 30,000 people that may be involved with them, use a figure there, from Atlanta to, say, Charlotte. That would then be something brings about, again, the insight from the state, saying, well, that's a major player that we want to try and attract to the state. So there's a need for some confidentiality during that process, unfortunately, and until it becomes relevant to saying we've got the bid, or even when we don't get it, that information becomes available at that point in time.
Let me take questions.
Can I go back to something you said, Tom, so I don't make sure I understand it. When you were saying that the Open Records Act, there's an exception for Georgia Department of Economic Development and others in these secret negotiations, did you say, though, that before it's finally voted on, it has to be revealed? What did you say about when it has to become public? Can you say that again?
In other words, they can negotiate the deal and reach final terms,
yeah,
and then it has to be disclosed as part of the voting process. In other words, when it's finally approved by the General Assembly and the governor, the terms have to be disclosed.
At the time they're voting, not a time before. You're saying when it comes up for a vote, that's when we, as the public, the press, will finally see it.
Exactly.
I gotcha, okay.
And let me, Chairman Willard, the open records and open meetings laws don't apply to the legislature. It's a matter of constitutional law in Georgia, but so we rely on the General Assembly's own sense of the obligation of openness to make its proceedings and records available. If there is a special session, that will be open, will it not?
Correct. Now, and follow what Tom was saying, the General Assembly provides, you might say, a fund and program, we'll call it, for the Economic Development Department to have as incentives to be used. We don't always have a company like Amazon coming here, but there are companies coming who are looking for, again, they're checking out several locations, and they may have one in Georgia looking at, so Economic Development is making incentive programs available to bring that employer here, and those come out of a regular fund set up for that purpose.
Do we have any questions for the panel right
here? So there's no time between the time that a deal is secret, privately negotiated and written, till the time that the bill is passed. There is no time in there when that record would be open. So in other words, it could be a done deal without any access to the information. There's no time that, you know, would be available. It would be done before anybody had an opportunity to review it other than the lawmakers. Is that what you're saying?
Well, the lawmakers don't get involved in it. You have the governor's office and the executive branch are the ones who are really doing the day-to-day work and negotiations. It becomes known when a deal is either put together or we fail to obtain that particular company coming here. We have available what would be the record of what we offer, even though we failed. So all that becomes public information, either when there's been the decision they're coming here or the decision they're not coming here.
I agree with that.
In other words, it
takes place on the executive branch to a great deal. The Georgia General Assembly funds the executive branch's decision, but the executive branch negotiates the deal and then announces the deal and signs the deal. And so the opportunity for public input and debate, there really is very little of opportunity for that. It's basically public disclosure and then the agreement's executed virtually simultaneously. And so it is potentially an enormous government undertaking where there is not a lot of opportunity or time for public input into it. But Representative Willard's exactly right, that they're really just the funding mechanism, and that's why a special session may be necessary, because it, what we're talking about in Amazon is an enormous amount of funds.
They expect to be over $1 billion.
That's a
good point. Whatever the negotiations, and that's why they'll have to bring us back in special session. If, in fact, we're to that point, and there's been a meeting of the minds conditioned upon the General Assembly approving it because of the size of what we're talking about as far as the potential benefits going with it.
Yeah. Just to add in a unique caveat from the local level, I didn't think about this, but if you have your chambers of commerce involved, that is not necessarily a public entity, and things can also take place behind closed doors in that space.
Another question over here, I think.
I want to ask a question. We have some lawyers up here, but again, this isn't legal advice. I'm a reporter, and I do my open records requests, and the agency hasn't designated an open records officer. I send it to, the communications person. They don't have a clear grasp of what's in the law, and so I do end up going to that formal, please accept this request under the open records law. What is advice from anybody here for dealing with state, county, city agencies to get records? I understand that their number one priority is, keeping the streetlights on or filling potholes. Dealing with my request isn't their number one priority. How can I get them to want to help me?
By the way, I'm a freelancer and my budget is zero. I will never have a lawyer.
I only want to amplify what you're saying, mm-hmm. because I don't have great advice for you, but just to, right, this is what we're talking about when we're saying we don't have a lot of recourse in something like this. Because even if you think we have tons of resources where I work, right, to litigate, this is the situation that we're talking about, that it's not considered a priority, that it's not considered something that comes naturally to government. And it creates a sense of frustration because she's very likely trying to tell her, do a public service for her community. And more often than not, and I appreciate your position, you have to sit there and bring in the big bad lawyers to fight that fight, right? So I just only want to amplify what you're saying and underscore that, but please.
But you can't get attorney's fees. It's a matter of having to force it.
You can.
But you're leaving the legislature soon, right? I think I have your cell phone number. Perhaps I could.
Okay.
I would say that Georgia has a couple things going for it in this regard that some states don't. One is there is a time frame for response. It's supposed to be a reasonable amount of time, not to exceed 3 business days. They have to provide you certain things, and if they don't, there's some consequences that would make it even more difficult for them if they get into a lawsuit.
I'm never going to be CNN.
And another option is that the Attorney General's office here set up a number of years ago and has maintained an open government mediation service. It's used more, they represent the state, so it's not as effective with state agencies, but if you're dealing with a local entity, they can often be helpful in making that agency more responsive than they would otherwise be. That's one option. And then there are entities like the Georgia First Amendment Foundation, which tries to educate officials. It's not really in the business of helping with individual requests, but if you bring a request to its attention, and it's the kind of thing that's coming up frequently, they'll try to do something to help. Right, Richard?
Yes absolutely.
And let me just add some practical things that I think are helpful. Number one, I'm a big fan of don't frame your request very broadly in the beginning. In other words, a lot of times I will see Open Records Act requests saying, I want all and every record relating to some subject. that immediately puts the agency on a defensive because they're trying to figure out all and every record. Whoa, that could be multiple departments, and then you tend to get a backup fee request that's in the thousands of dollars. If you want a specific memo or a specific letter, ask just for that. Try and get that, and then frequently looking at that memo, there'll be other things referenced. And then try and submit another Open Records Act growing from there. I think that process helps create a dialogue with the agency in just the way that Lisa was mentioning, where they're understanding, all right, they wanted that record, now they want these records which relate to that record, and frequently goes better in that way. But I think trying to start with a narrow request and broadening and trying to open a dialogue are the two things that typically make the Open Records Act process go better. There's some situations where it never goes well, but those help, I think, in the process.
Just saying something as simple as, I'm trying to get hold of X record, can you help me?
Mm-hmm.
Certainly comes across better, and people want to be in a position to help. And there have been times when I have, as elected official, I've run the open records request. So if you can't get something, I've had people say, you're my elected official, I'm looking for this document. And so I'll go to staff and say, I need you to run, you know, the system for any term that is X or Y and forward me those documents. And they'll have to be responsive to that elected official.
I think we had one there.
This is a question for the whole panel, or anyone on the panel. To what extent has the judicial application of sovereign immunity had on transparency? That's broadly speaking, but if you want to refer more specifically to the civil case brought by Attorney Stephen Humphreys, I'd be happy to hear that as well.
I'm not familiar with the civil case. I know you have bills relating to...
Yeah, let me give a background. For our sovereign immunity, sure. There's been a strange things happened the last several years in Georgia with regards to being able to sue local or state governments and agencies to stop what may be a wrongful conduct by either individuals in that department or the whole agency. So, with that said, court decisions of the Supreme Court have recognized the king can do no wrong, in terms used, meaning that the state can do no wrong, and we've really lost the ability to have the ability to go into court and seek injunctive relief or a declaratory judgment, the terms are used. That means to try and get the court to give you some relief. Now, we had a bill that we passed. I went through the House 1 year, went through the Senate the next year. It was vetoed by the governor. To go back to what we thought was the law on sovereign immunity before these decisions came out. I reintroduced the bill this year, and I did so because the governor had a commission or council to look at several things. One was sovereign immunity, and they recognized we got a problem, which we don't. But they're not wanting to have it go back to where it was as far as the state. So they've come with their own bill. I filed a bill which was a much broader state and local governments. So we're going to start having a debate very shortly on this whole issue of sovereign immunity. But it's a real problem in Georgia right now. People don't recognize it. It's being applied to zoning, meaning you cannot challenge a local government for a zoning decision. And that's a really called a revolution.
So far, it has not been a practical issue in, I think, for the most part, in the open records and open meetings context.
It's just fairness in governance, what yeah. It is. Yeah.
Jennifer, you had a
question back on the Open Records Act. I'm getting concerned, increasingly concerned about the fees. And I just wanted to ask you, what are your opinions on the fees? Do we have enough controls on the fees? And is there something we should be thinking about on the fees? Because we got one from DFACS, with WXA, we got one from DFACS, and I have a reporter who's a master at asking for exactly what he wants. He's practically an expert on this. and they came back and said it was $64,000. So I went on TV that night and said, well, we've asked for these records, but DFAF says it's $64,000, so imagine how deep this problem must be. And then guess what? We got the records. So now I'm wondering, how is this? How are the fees being used to stop us?
Could I add to that before you answer it?
Please.
Just for the folks who don't know, in the 2012 bill, we made a little bit of a trade that I think killed us in some ways. We agreed to reduce the price of records from 25 cents a page to 10 cents a page, and the agencies went along with that, but they said, oh, but we need to have the ability to charge more for redaction. And that is what is killing us, because there's no transparency around the redaction, and citizens and journalists are both getting outrageous and ridiculous redaction costs in the bill. And then when you push back or you embarrass them, often it comes back and it goes from thousands of dollars to $100. And so I feel that there is no doubt, I mean, there's certainly agencies that are wonderful and try to deal in good faith, but there's no doubt that there are agencies that are using the redaction fee to try to dissuade records requests. I don't know what the remedy to that is. Love to hear ideas.
Any response?
So I absolutely agree that redaction fees has emerged as a huge problem in the Open Records Act. And if there is any area that I encourage people to scrutinize closely, it's redaction fees. Because what is a government allowed to charge and what is it not allowed to charge? It's allowed to charge for the lowest priced person capable of physically accomplishing the redaction. And just so everybody understands, redaction is basically removing from a document some portion of that document that is legitimately outside the scope of the Open Records Act. A good example would be Social Security numbers. The Social Security numbers of government employees and private citizens are not supposed to appear in documents that are provided by the government under the Open Records Act. So they're supposed to be eliminated in some form. Sometimes that's done digitally, sometimes it's literally done just with a black magic marker. But it's supposed to be the lowest cost employee capable of carrying out that function. It is not supposed to be the cost of the lawyers that directed what should be removed. Legal fees are not allowed to be included in the costs for redaction, and Representative Willard was a very important part in making clear that's not a part of the costs of the Open Records Act, because it can drive the potential bill way, way up. But that was considered in the rewrite of the Open Records Act. It was introduced for a short period of time, and it was removed from the Open Records Act that got passed in 2012 and eliminated in the committee process. And so I frequently think when you see crazy numbers, it's because they are charging not for the lowest cost employee, they are charging for every individual that possibly could review the record, including attorneys, to decide what will be redacted. And that's the part that can evaporate on input if pushed back. I do think that's a place where the Attorney General's office could be very helpful in giving clear direction and making an issue of it in some of their enforcement activities, because that will send a message to government agencies that that's an improper way to try and intimidate people out of asking for records.
And I believe they did in Middle Georgia, they had a case where the mayor said he was the lowest paid employee who could redact, and they spanked him a little bit.
Well, I do think it was great that you were so transparent with our audience about that, because I know a lot of times as journalists we try not to be a part of this story and to report the news, but that's very much the public's right to know what they're charging for you to give information that would serve the public. So good on you for doing that. I applaud you.
Our time is up. Let me please join me in thanking the panel. I'm sure many of you will say that.
If you are not a member of the Georgia First Amendment Foundation and would like to become one, see me or Sean or Kathy, we'd be happy to sign you up.
It wasn't a really neat project, but we were on the side of the editor, and so.
We made a friend.
Yeah.
They're 2 minutes short.